I think you need to unmute him. He got muted.
Yeah, I am here. I'm sure.
So you live in India or you live in some other country?
I live in Uruguay, so I'm like up and down because of work.
Okay, nice. So how come Uruguay?
I work with with an IT firm, so they keep sending me here and back to India
Sure.
for work purpose, yeah.
Okay. And what's your general poker experience? Like, have you worked on your game anywhere, or have you studied or anything, or like just to get a rough idea before we start?
Yeah, so basically how I started was I was in Mexico in 2016. So from
Okay.
there I got in touch with poker because I used to go to casino and play, blackjack and stuff. But then I quickly realized it's not a game for us.
Yeah.
So yeah, so then I started poker, watching YouTube videos,
Okay.
and then I didn't get much success then because it was still the starting phase. And then I started reading Super System. From Doyle
Okay.
Johnson, and then I started getting into the game slowly. So it started in 2016, and after that, I don't play. I was not regular then, but
Okay.
yeah, when came back to India in 2018, I was, and when PokerStars app got launched, at that time I started again, and then from then I'm pretty much regular, and I keep studying as well. So
Okay.
that's
How are
how it is.
you studying? Like, what do you generally do when you study?
So what happens is like most of the time what I saw when I started, right, I was always on tilt,
Okay.
try yeah, so just watch YouTube videos and try to look at my hand history. I didn't
Okay.
use any of the softwares, but yeah, I'm thinking to use it because currently I'm having machine issues, meaning I'm on client machine and I cannot install anything. And usually I play from poker app, which is on my cell phone. So these are the challenges which I'm facing right now. So it's becoming difficult for me. But yeah, I do try to look at what could I have done, go past to my hand history and check whether I should have played this hand at all or not, whether should I raised, jammed, something like that. So I review it like that, but yeah, not from the software perspective, or I don't use the tuning, to know the player as well. So it's completely based on the experience. And most of the I only play in PokerStars, so
Okay.
I kind of now have how each player is playing, although there may be new players adding up, but I do have everything in my mind, like who is going to play how. So it's been 3 years now, and so based on experience, I'm going on, man.
Okay, but you haven't worked on like any sort of pre-flop ranges or any sort of post-flop study or anything, or
Yeah,
use
so
any softwares?
I did I do have my ranges in my mind, but not on the in the I've not gone into software and looked at it.
Okay, no problem. I think we can start. The plan is we'll just like we'll not go through every hand. We'll just skip through hands that you played, and then we can discuss on that. And in case it's taking too long, because my goal is to like finish some post-flop stuff and also do final table trivia, because I think that's a little more important. In case it happens that we're running out of time, then we will skip the middle stages and try to jump to the final
The
table.
final table, yeah.
Yeah. And the early part of the hand history, we will go over very quickly. We do not spend too much time onto it. The reason is like when we're playing very, very deep, it's not a big part of our MTT time. Like we should majorly be focusing on 10 to 40 BB play. Like if you have 100 BBs, that doesn't really, and we study that, it's not too important in like how often do you play 100 BBs, and the importance of that isn't much because that'd be early stages. So we'll start here, and we'll go over quickly in the early stages.
Right, and also this particular tournament I joined day two,
Yeah.
so Yeah, so it was already like kind of, late when I joined. So my aim was to, jam all the pockets and ASICs. That's what my plan was, and get my
I
stack
mean,
built
when you have 20 BBs, you kind of
up.
have to play that. But it's
True.
like it's not a. So one thing I would like to just inform, it's not a good thing to register so late. And
Right.
the other thing is like people often is think that you should register at the start of the tournament. I also don't agree with that, because for to play if you joining from the first hand, you need to play 100 BB, 150 BBs deep. And the dynamics of 100 to 150 BBs are completely different, and you'll have to spend so much time studying. So I generally recommend you should probably buy in somewhere around 60 to 80 big blinds and not register below 25, 30 big blinds. Like obviously if it's like a very special tournament or a very low blind tournament and you register 20 big blinds, it's okay. But generally, like this is what I think most of your edge will come from playing 20 to 80 big, 60 big blinds.
Right, I agree with you.
Yeah, this is like standard. So in spots like these where it's just a easy standard shove, we will just skip over very quickly. Limping is okay, and I don't mind if you if your opponent's a really good rig and his stats seem quite decent. I wouldn't mind if you just go ahead and open shove this.
Okay. Yeah, I really need to work on my small blind play as well, because most of the time I end up folding, and I've seen
Yeah.
people, yeah. So I really need to work on that, because
And
I really.
that's the toughest part, because when you're playing under the gun, your range is so narrow. It's fairly easy to play. When you're on the small blind, your range is probably going to be the widest, and BB's range is also going to be the widest. So it's wide range versus wide range, and that's a little tricky to play.
Right, but true, but the problem occurs, when, and usually we have that button always, tries to raise. So at that moment, what we need to do, that's what basically, I need to work, because it's always either hijack or, cut off, or button always tries
Yeah.
to raise, and
I think for
then.
that you should work on two things. One is your preflop range, because this is why I said, right, that 30 BB play and 100 BB play are completely different. Your flatting range at 100 BBs is going to be very different, and your flatting range at 25, 30 big blinds, even button versus small blind, is going to be very, very different. And I
Okay.
think a lot of people make this mistake, because I've seen tournaments where people three bet hands, which are really good three bets at 30, 40 big blinds. But they also use the same hands at 100, 150 big blinds, which is not quite true. This seems okay. I think it's fine after you limp. So if you had like 60 big blinds here, right? So right now you have 20 big blinds. If you have 60 big blinds, what do you think your strategy would have been on the flop?
I would have played it the same way. I thought I'm since I'm seeing it now, I think I should have showed it. I mean, jammed aces
No,
over here, maybe.
raising is we're not jamming 20 big, even 15 big blinds. We're not jamming. We're actually doing a lot of raising at 15, even 13, 14 big blinds. You can do a lot of raise call and raise fold. But to keep it simple, if you're playing fairly tight and don't want to have a raising range at 14, 15 big blinds, it's okay. But at 20 big blinds, you definitely need to raise this. You shouldn't be jamming.
Okay.
The thing is, so here your sizing is kind of okay. I would lean towards betting a little bigger. And the
Okay.
reason is like if you bet 3000 here, so first two things. First of all, if you had say 80 big blinds, 60 big blinds deep, this is not a c-bet on the flop. It's just a straightforward check. You pretty much
Okay.
don't c-bet anything here. And this is one mistake which people make in MTTs, where they assume that 10 high boards, nine. So let's say the board is 9-3 twos, 7-3 twos. Those boards are not cutoffs boards. Those boards are good boards for the button. And in general, cutoff versus button, you don't really do a lot of c-betting. The only boards that you get to c-bet are basically king highs and some ace highs, not all ace highs. The reason for this is like when you're opening here, right? You have ace king, you have king queen, you have queen jack, you have 8-9 suited, you have aces, kings, queens also, you have king queen off, you have king jack off. All these hands are there in your range, right? So if you look at your entire range, it is so Broadway heavy that you actually miss this board with a very high frequency. What is your opponent's range? Does he have ace king? No. Does he have ace queen? No. Probably not even king queen. Probably not even king jack. He even three bets some of his ace x's. So ace jack, ace nine, ace eight suited. Maybe he three bets some frequency. So if you he actually ends up showing with a lot of middling pairs, like weak pairs, which he doesn't want to jam, though he should. But that's the kind of range he will come up with. So we generally don't want to be betting here. And let's say he has a hand like queen jack. You don't really achieve anything by folding out queen jack. Yeah. But at 20 big blinds, we definitely see bet, and we see bet on a bigger size. We don't really see bet a small size.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a big deal. Yeah, just jam. Seems fine. I wouldn't go too much into sizings, otherwise we'll end up wasting a lot of time.
Okay.
I wouldn't do this. I would stick to one size. But I mean, if you have a, like if you, this is your standard size at 40 big blinds, it's fine. But I generally just do min raise, no matter what blind level it is. It just makes the game simple, but it also helps me play more tables. But it really depends on what sizing you're choosing. This three bet is good. I would go a little bigger, maybe like 6.97. No, I think this is also borderline okay. It's just little small. Yeah, now we just fold. We'd even, I think, folding if under the gun plus one jams. But here it's an easy fold.
Yeah, if it would have been suited, should I be calling there? Or?
Yeah, so if this was suited, at this stack depth, you're always calling. If you were deeper, say if you were like 100 big blinds deep or so, then I would lean more towards 3-betting. The calling is also okay, even at 100 big blinds, but I prefer playing more 3-bet strategy at deeper stacks.
Okay.
I don't mind if you jam this. Calling is also okay. I think I prefer jamming because it's somewhat... this guy is all in this, so there's more money in the pot, and he's opening fairly wide, 32-27. That's a bit wide, and his EPMP RFI is also very, very wide. He's opening 25% from EP, 36% from MP, 57 from cutoff. So I don't mind. I think I would rather jam this than call here. Like even at 30 big blinds, it's fine to just jam.
Okay.
Okay, I would still prefer to just check. Yeah. And yeah, I don't really see much. I don't think we get heroed by ace high, and definitely not this size, because this size is just never a bluff. And he still has hands like eights, nines. He still has 7-8 kind of 7x, some weak 10x's that he would check the flop with. So this side, because you never have a bluff here, right? What hands do you bluff here that ace high is good versus?
I missed straight maybe. So no.
Yeah, but you don't use this size for it, right? Because you expect to get called very high frequency. That's why you choose this size. Yeah, this is okay to call. And so you should take a mental note. Like it may just be that Swanger Ray probably got hands, but you should be careful and just make a note that he's. Maybe he's squeezing a lot. So this is one fairly big mistake. What's your intention? Like, is this like a value bet or is this a bluff?
No, what I was thinking is, since he has very his stack is very low, right? So I thought on ace high board he should be betting.
You the initial raiser, so it'll always be you who's going to bet.
Oh, okay. Can you go back? I didn't see that. Who raised it?
You raised and he defended the big blind.
Ah, okay. So in this case, right, since I raised, I Definitely, most of the time have
So, what is
an
your
ace.
goal in poker? Do you want to win number of hands or do you want to win number of, like amount of chips?
Amount of chips, definitely.
Yeah. So if he doesn't have an ace and he folds, what did you achieve?
I
He
get
doesn't have
the.
it. Yeah, but then that's a simple rule. Just make this like your life's thumb rule in poker. You bet to get worse hands to call or better hands to fold. Anytime you bet and a worse hand folds, you lose money. Now, it's
So
not
in this case, there will
100%
be
true.
very low chances he might be having ace and king. So
Yeah.
if you would like him to continue, that's what your
No, no.
point.
So this is a basic rule. It isn't always true because at in certain spots you kind of just have to bet your entire range. And then you'll be betting some weaker pairs and stuff also, which there's other reasons for it. Like I don't want to get too much into detail into it. But basically, if we bet here, right, our goal is first of all, his stack size is so short that there's no room left for making any plays. He kind of just has to play his hand. So if he has an ace or a king, he just has to go with it. If he doesn't, he just has to fold. So our goal here is not to really extract value because it's not a value bet. And we don't really want to, if we bet big here, we're technically bluffing with this hand, which we don't want to do, not versus this stack. So I would just go ahead and bet one big blind with every single hand. If you have an ace, if you have king, so in a spot like this, sometimes it's kind of bad. It feels bad, but even a hand like queens, we would just bet one BB just to make the game very simple. So just bet one big blind and that's it. End of story. He can't play back at you. If he jams here, you're anyways not calling. So there's no reason to bet 2400, 1200, like even 1201 isn't required. When you're playing sub 15 BB stacks, you kind of lean, majority of the boards, you will be having a 1 BBC bet strategy on at least these sort of boards, like more dry,
True, but
disconnected boards.
I'm not giving him here a chance, you know, to what if he senses weakness, right? If I say if I go with 1200, if
What
he has
is
something
going
to.
to happen is irrelevant because let's say he does that. And that's also a very minute chance of that happening. But let's say he does that. What you're forgetting is you have nines right now, but you also have aces. You also have kings. And majority of your range is like ace x seven because you have all suited ace x's. You have all king Broadway hands, even king nine, king eight suited sort of hands. So you actually have a lot of hands and he can't really be playing back at you. Let's say he senses weakness and he wants to play back. He kind of just has to commit his entire stack. Because even if you bet 1200, what's he going to do? Make it 6k and fold? Make it 5k and fold?
No, yeah, he will definitely jam, but in that case, I don't have a way to call, right? I mean, I'll have to definitely
No.
fold.
So then save your chips. No, why are you betting 24? Bet 1200. Because whether you bet 24 or 1200, and you like we are not betting 1200 because we have nines. We are betting 1200 no matter what hand we have. So if we have an ace, we still bet 1200.
Got
It
it.
doesn't matter what a hand. You need to stop thinking about your hand and start thinking about your range. You need to start thinking about his range. Because he's not some like no one. None of you are going to be able to figure out exact hands. You'll just be wasting time and still coming to wrong conclusions. You think about your range. You think about his range. That's it. And in this case, your range is always going to be stronger on a side boards because you're the razor. Plus, his stack size is so short that he can't really do anything. Let's say he wants to bluff here. What are going to be the good bluff candidates? He's never really going to be able to do that here because he there's no turn play left after check. Is there probably even a flop bluff? If you go slightly bigger, would have to be he'll be forced to jam. And what bluffs do you think he comes up here with? And if you think about it, like I should just skip it, but yeah, like basically 15 BBs or lower on these boards, stick to 1 BB or 1.2 BB big blind sizings. Don't really need to go this big. This is just way too big. And we kind of lose a lot
Got
of
it.
chips. Yeah, if we get jammed on. Yeah, so this I don't really understand. And I would recommend just sticking to same size, because
The
you
same size,
min
yeah.
raised here, nines you min raised, and then you make a little bigger. So don't do that. Just stick to one size.
Got it.
I'm not sure how comfortable you are, but I would probably not fold this. He does seem a little bit tight when he's three betting, but man, we don't really have a. I mean, there is somewhat sample, but yeah, I mean, for this size in position, it's not even, it's barely like 3.3x or so. I would not fold this. I mean, we kind of have to get it in whenever we flop anything. Yeah, you can size down here because he doesn't really have any chips, right? So even if you go like 5k here, it's fine. It's it, what happens is when you go 5k, 5.5k, for example, over here, it doesn't matter what size you go for, in this case versus Satan, the guy who initially opened, because no matter what size you choose, you're committed.
Right.
But you're not committed versus Chicago. You're not committed versus broke. You're not committed versus Narcos. You're not committed versus them. That is why if we choose a size like 5, 5.5K, and with our entire range, not just aces, like no matter what we have. And this is one specific spot that allows us to do this. It's not that we choose 5, 5.5K versus everyone. It's just because he has like 11, 12 big blinds. You make it 5K, and if Chicago, this Swango Ray or broke three bet, four bets or jams, you still have a folding range. And that will save your chips. Like if you have, say, a hand like sevens here and you ready to commit versus him, but then Swango Ray jams or Swango Ray four bets and broke jams and you need to fold. And their play, like Swango Ray and broke, pretty much do the same thing, whether you have, like whether you make 5K or whether you make 8K. Yeah, this is a little wide, but it's okay. Although like when you opening this, this you should probably just fold. And the reason is like this table specifically doesn't really seem to be a very soft table. The I don't know who the guy on your left and left are, the two guys, but they seem reggy. The stats seem reggy.
Both of
big
them.
Big blind is a good reg. Small blind's a good reg. So you should actually be tightening up here.
Right. If it would have been a late position, then I could have.
Like even late position, it's still tricky versus this lineup. But of course, from cutoff and button, you of course open this. Another thing you need to look at is BB is a good trick. And he has a very big stack. So he's going to defend wider. Button, we have no information. But he also has a big stack. So you need to think about these things before you start opening this wide. Like every pair is not an open. It's going to be hard to make money otherwise.
Got it.
Yeah. Versus small blind, hey, this is okay. And I think calling's also fine. I don't really see why we should jam.
This was one. Maybe I couldn't call this because of my stack as well.
Yeah, this seems very weird line though. I don't think this makes any sense. By me, it's kind of a bad river. Probably one of the few rivers that we get to fold. Although I don't see how many ace-x he gets here with. Because if he has hands like ace-10 or stuff, I don't see them betting the turn. They have showdown, they wouldn't bet the turn. So he's actually repping very, very thin. I don't mind if he called off here. Because his range is going to be more hands like Jack 10 of spades and 7-8 of spades, right? If you look at Ace King, Ace Queen, Ace Jack, they probably either get in pre or they don't bet the turn. So, and he doesn't really like sixes and fives also expected to go in pre. Yeah, I think I might just call it off.
Okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't probably fold.
Okay. The only reason why I didn't call because of my stack. If it would have been,
I understand. But like at the end of the day, like I said, right? The first thing you look at is his range, your range. If you think about his range, there's actually very few ASICs that make sense. Sure, he can show up at set sometimes, but that is it alone, right? Even if the river was a brick, we were calling off anyways. But he still has spades, and you don't block any spade card.
Got it.
Yeah, just I think you should just jump D. Seems fine. I am not sure why you want to jump this here.
Kanchachina opened it, right?
Yeah.
And no one else behind, so.
No. The thing is, he's opening from a very short stack. It's generally going mm-hmm. to be a very, very nutted range. And he's also very tight. Like, it's 53 hands, but he's opening 34-8. So he's just opening 8%. Usne bhi he's opening from a 10 BB stack. I'm already a bit concerned about this race. Like, I don't... I mean, most of the time, this is going to be fairly strongish range. Yeah, like I said, right? The moment someone with 10 BB, 11 BB starts min raising, and I'll give you an example. The first hand that we discussed, right? We spoke about you were more keen to jam at 20 big blinds, majority of your hands.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's aces, you'll always open. And this is true when people get to 13, 14 big blinds. And when they open, they know they should open aces. Everyone knows that. But what are your bluffs? No one knows that. And in reality, what happens is when such a short stack opens, you often, since they don't know what their bluff, like raise folding range is, they end up having more of a raise call range. And that raise call range at 12 BB is extremely nutted.
Agree. Yeah, got it.
I mean, in general, I think the only hands I would jam here are pretty much aces, kings, queens, jacks, cry and jam. But that's about it. Like obviously an ace king as well.
Okay.
So this I would not 3-bet, and I would just call. And this is why I said, like, there's a lot of mistakes people make at 30 BB and 100 BB side. Okay, you're on the button. You have the nut best position. If you 3-bet here and he jams, I think the worst hand he shows here is going to be like you either flipping or he probably has a better hand most of the time. Like, sure, people end up spew shoving worse hands. But I think in general, this hand has a lot higher EV as a call. Like, I don't mind if you choose a hand like the offsuit versions of these hands, you're better off calling you because you're on the button. If you were in any other position, not blinds, not buttons. Say you were in gutshot hip dose position, then ace queen suited is still a call, but hands like ace queen off, ace track off, you can now start 3-betting. So when you're shorter, the more suited versions you start flatting. So hands like king jack suited, ace queen suited, they go into your flatting range, and the offsuit versions go into your 3-bet range. And as you get deeper, say you're sitting with 100 big blinds, then the reverse happens. You probably fold the offsuit versions from middle position, and if you call, you call some of them. But majority of your suited versions, they go into your 3-bet range. And which changes completely when you get short. It's just reverse. Like you, in general, just make a note that the deeper you are, the more suited stuff you 3-bet. And the shorter you are, the more offsuit stuff you 3-bet. And more suited stuff you start flatting.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, seems fine. We'll just skip it. We won't look at the results. Yeah, again, like this is just so huge. It's not needed. And you probably don't even need to see that here. Just check it back. Because, when you go this size, he's not near folding a king, queen. He's not a king or a queen or a jack or something. But you basically getting to for the weaker stuff. And you don't really need protection versus them. Do you need protection versus a hand like, say, 6-7 off?
No.
So your hand doesn't really need protection. Maybe versus ace-5, sure. But that's what? Three cards left? Three aces left if he has a hand like this. And this is such a big waste of chips. And we have equity also. Like, you know, we can outdraw his king-x, queen-x if we hit a straight or something. But we just burned that. So be careful. Like, when you see these sort of boards, think about your range and what your hand also wants to do. Just don't think, okay, this is my board, I should see. But no, there's no such thing. There's no such thing as your board, his board, and I should always see. But no, think of your range, his range, and then see what your range wants to do. And then think about what your hand wants to do.
Right. I think that is the thinking which I most of the time end up doing. Since I opened, I have to bet like that.
No, there's no such thing.
Right.
I don't mind if you stab the turn, because we like this hand needs a lot of protection, right? This hand needs protection from random eight, king eight suited, for example.
Flushes and straights, so yeah.
Call is fine. Yeah, I mean it's kind of icky, but for this size, it's okay to peel one. But I'm not too comfortable here, and I wouldn't really like if he goes a little bigger. I don't mind just folding because he's bet into three people. It's kind of hard, but this size for sure we can peel one. Yeah, just fold the turn. Yeah, I strongly recommend looking at ranges because you're opening when you're opening into these two short stacks. This hand is extremely bad.
Got it, yeah. Because I cannot call his jam.
Yeah, and it's also a hand that doesn't really play well post. Because these guys, if they hit anything, if small b sorry, big blind, if he hits anything, he's just gonna jam. So you can't even like c bet and expect him to fold every single time. Or like
True,
just call
true.
and play post. It's not gonna happen. Yeah, seems fine. If he, I mean, he's just sized it so much that we, like in
Yeah.
spots like these, we just play a hand. There's no thought process needed.
Right.
So I think you were a little too fixated on pairs and stuff. And here's the thing that I wanted to show you. On a board like this, you're out of position and you still see betting. And now that you have a stronger hand, you're betting a smaller size. And if you go back to this hand, pocket nines, you have a weaker hand and you're betting a large size, percentage wise. Now, if you are actually playing to make money, what's the best way? Let's say you're trying to exploit, and then that's why you're changing your sizings and everything. Then when you have a
Right.
weak hand, bet small. When you have a strong hand, bet big.
True, true.
But
Now, since I'm seeing it, I think I should add check back because what if he folds, right? I am not getting any value.
no, it's not about what he folds. Again, it doesn't matter what he does. You first of all, like this, it's a common leak in people where they have a weaker hand, they bet bigger because they want people to fold, and they bet too small when they want people to call. Aisa mat socho. What is happening is you're playing a strategy to win minimum and lose maximum. Because when you have a weak hand, you bet big and he calls, you lose. When you have a strong hand, he calls, you still lose. Because he could have called more. That's why
Got it.
forget about what if he folds, what if he calls, what if he raises. No. What is your range? What is his range? End of story. So here, I would not bet this. I would just check 100% of my range. Whether I have queen 10 suited, aces, or pocket fours, or pocket queens, it doesn't matter. We just check 100% because you have sixes, you have ace jack suited, you have tens, nines, eights. You have all these middling range. He, on the other hand, has more queen x's. So, what? We can actually take a look at this and see if we can. So forget our hand right now.
Okay.
But if I ask you a simple question, that what is your calling range? Let's say you are in Warren's shoes, and this guy's open. What hands do you call? Not three, right? Just call. In this spot, it's UTG versus sorry UTG plus one versus MP kind of range. So what's your middle position calling range to stack depth?
I'll call any suited connectors.
Yeah, so let me start off by saying that these are not calls. All these are just straight up folds. I think we'd have more hands like these.
Right.
Something like this. So I'll just do some, I'm not gonna write in frequencies and stuff and all that. Maybe something like this. And let's say if you actually give him suited connectors, it's, let's just give him some suited connectors. And then maybe something like this. This is just a rough idea. It's obviously not correct range tree, and people play the ranges differently, but I just want to show you something. So if you look at this here, he has 16% top pairs. This is also, he has 13% middle pairs. And he has like 26% ace highs and stuff. So if it's in general, he still has like almost 30 and then almost 33-34% of hands that don't really fold. Even his ace highs are relatively strong because he doesn't have like ace three off and ace four off kind of hands. And
right.
he still has sets like 6% of the time. So six plus 16 plus 13 plus three. So that's almost 35-40%, almost 40% of the times, close to 40% of the times that your opponent is not going to fold. Now, at the same time, if you put up your range, like let's just put up a very simple. I'm not going to put exact ranges, just a rough idea. So you have overpair, you have sets 3%, you have overpair 4.7%, your top pair, your middle pair. But look at the other amount of hands that you have. You have 40%, 32%, 33% of ace size. You have 18% of no made hands. That's already 50% of your range. That has nothing on this board. There's weak pair, which doesn't really want to bet. So that's 60% of range that doesn't want to bet in bloat pots. Add another 3.5%. So that's 64, around 63-64% of hands of your range don't want to bet. Plus 10%. So almost 75% of your range doesn't want to bet here.
Yeah. Okay.
And he's not folding 40-45% of the times.
Right.
So in this part, you should just be checking your entire range. And I split just jam. Like he's, I think we often just see hands like king, queen suited and stuff here. Or ace queen. So if we add these ranges, because I did not add those in his situation before, but if we add hands like ace queen off, which I don't think people do that often, but if we add that, then he probably ends up having 50% of hands that are not going to fold the flop.
Right.
Yeah, this is okay. Probably the lowest hands that we've had. Oh, no. We just check it down. There is no reason to bet this hand four-way. Like, sure, it sucks if the river is like a queen and some random queen five suited wins it, or queen ten kind of hands win it. But four-way, people are going to be so straightforward that no one's going to bet a jack, no one's going to bet a nine, and they're not even going to fold. Plus, they still have hands that have equity. Like I said, right? No one's going to bet an eight or a nine or a jack, and no one's going to fold those hands either.
Right.
Just check it down. You have showdown. Like, don't like try to differentiate your hand between in different categories. Is this a bluff? Is this a showdown hand? Is this a value bet? Am I betting for protection? Try to think about it, because when you have a showdown hand, you don't bet. When you're betting for protection, it's going to be a small size. For example, the nines hand on king ten, not nines. What was the other hand? There was some hand where you had ace, king, x, and you had nines. You're basically betting for protection from random jack x or king x, queen x. If that's the case, then you size down. You don't size up. And when you play multiway, your ranges have to be even stronger, because the stack of threshold we need, or even the betting threshold we need when we multiway, is extremely high. So even if you had, say, a hand like queen jack suited, right? That's still probably okay to bet, but sizing would be smaller. Like, I'd probably not bet, no matter what hand we have, we don't bet more than like 6K or something. And like 9X, if this was heads up and we had a hand like ace nine suited, then we would definitely bet if your opponent checks twice. But in this case, we still don't bet.
Right.
I'd be careful with this, these sort of flats that you do, because even at 30, 35 big blinds, these hands are not really that good flats, because you need to think about Like you're looking at fives, and if I hit a set, I win a lot of money. But A, the problem is you can only win 75K. As in, if it's heads up. The problem is that if you play this hand a million times, just think about it in your head. The same spot, the same table, no chance opens, and you play this hand a million times, and these guys are still left to act after you. Do you think after a million times you would end up in profit with pocket fives?
No, I see.
Yeah. So be careful. It doesn't mean we always fold, but
right.
Just think about your ranges.
Understood.
You should run this in ICMizer. I don't think this is a call. This is fairly easy fold. But we'll leave the ICMizer stuff for later for more complicated stuff. Yeah, this is borderline, okay. No, we just fold the flop. There's no reason to be floating here. Like even his bluffs are still going to have a lot of equity. Plus, he's still going to be able to realize his equity more than you.
So, right. And most of the time I would do that. I don't know why I did over here.
Yeah, just fold it. And that's a drawback of playing short stack. Like we kind of just have to play our hand.
Yeah.
These are, I think this is also will be a jam. So we won't look into it. Yeah, seems fine. Seems fine. Yeah, seems fine. Open. This is close. I mean, I think you.
The
you should run this
diamond?
In ICMizer. Yeah, no, the ace queen off one. It's not a straightforward call, but I think it probably is going to be a call off. It's not. Maybe we'll leave that for it. I think these are hands you should just run in ICMizer.
Meaning you're saying I should have called most of the time?
No, I personally, I'm myself not 100% sure here what to
okay.
do. So I don't want to comment on something where I'm also not sure. Because okay. it seems like it's yucky to fold. And I don't think he shows up with hands like ace jack and ace ten and kind of like we'd be... He shows up with pairs, but then I'm not 100% sure. If he's good, right, then I would probably not. I have no idea who he is, but if he's like really good, right, then I would probably not fold because he's going to have hands, some hands like king, 10 suited and stuff that maybe they don't jam. But he's going to have basically a slightly wider range to jam. But honestly, I'm not sure. That, but we'll run this in ICMizer or HRC later on.
Okay.
In game, I probably, like, I don't know. Maybe I just toss a coin and call off. I don't think you need to go this big. Like a lot of people have seen some videos and then they think that on these ace track X EP versus BB, you should just size up, which is in general true. If you're playing with 60 to 100 big blinds, if you're playing such short stacks, you don't really want to size up. You actually want to size down. And I think I see a lot of people make this mistake even at like say 20 big blinds, they're betting huge on the flop. There may be some reasons to do it and sometimes it's right also, but I think people make more mistakes in that case. I don't mind just having a small 1/3 size here. You don't need to make this day. Sure, if you're like 60, 80 big blinds deep and you are following a complex post-flop strategy, then you could do that. Yeah, you could have a bigger size and a smaller size. This is tricky.
Yeah, this is tricky.
I probably wouldn't fold. I think I would still just call. Like even I know it seems yucky, but I mean, you can probably even fold some frequency. I probably would still call and 30 big blinds. Oh, okay. Sorry.
It's a hefty size. You know?
Yeah. I missed that size. Yeah, I think probably making an exploit fold here seems fine. So we won't go through this. Yeah, I don't like this at all. I mean,
calling.
Sure,
I should have raised.
We do want to have ace king and stuff in our flatting range, but I would strongly recommend for you to not do that at all. For you, like, you should just stick to below 50 big blinds. Ace king is just a straight up 3-bet. Like, there's a very few spots that you want to flat ace king, and those are spots that are going to be like under the gun versus big blind, or under the gun who's tight versus button, and you have 50 big blinds or so. But in general, for sub 40, 45 big blind, if you just 3-bet call off ace king, you're not going to be making any mistake. And it's always going to be profitable. Plus, you need to be very, very good post-up to be flatting ace king. So I would just recommend that for now, ace king is just a 3-bet. In pretty much any position, except the only position that you don't want to do that is UTG versus BB in a full 900 table. And that too, when you are relatively deep. Like, if you are 30, 35, 40 big blinds, then no, just 3-bet. I don't understand this 3-bet size. It's just, A, it's way too small. B, there's no reason to do that.
Like, I think my idea here was to show a really strong hand.
No, we don't show anything. Like I said, there is no such thing as I want to show this, he should do that, that is why I do this size. No, it's your range and it's your position. That's it. Your sizing pre-flop has to be consistent. It should never change with your hand. I want to show strong, so I do big. Aisa nahi karna. And this is, like I said, right? If you have aces, for example, and you do this, you have still lost money. Because... Okay. The way to win poker, if you're trying to exploit, because you're choosing this size because you're trying to exploit him. And if you're doing that, then your stronger hands should always bet bigger. It should not bet smaller. Because you make more money when you make a larger size. So if you have a strong hand, and if you want to rep a strong hand, you should be going bigger, not smaller.
Got it.
There's no version of him folding here for this size. There's just no hand that folds, and he's not making a mistake by calling 100% of his range here.
True.
Yeah, and I would, in a 3-bet pot, you probably should bet somewhere around like 20k, 25k. Like 20% of pot is way more than enough. This is just too big. Just stick to straightforward sizing. Let's say your 3-bet size is 3x in position over here. You probably can size down that to say 2.75 here, and that's simply because he made it 2.5x, so he's not min raised. He made it a bigger size, so all your 3-bets are now somewhere going to be just slightly less than 3x, or to say 42k or something like that. But you're never doing 36k. I want to show a strong hand, or no, whatever is standard is what you should stick to it. I don't mind this being a call. Sizing is also fine on the flop once he checks. On the turn, we'd go bigger. I'd probably go a little bigger. I think the size is fine. I think it's fine. Yeah, we don't fold the flop. But turn. No. 100% c-bet, and c-bet something like 14k or so, but 100% c-bet. There is no checking happening. I mean, actually, sorry, my bad. We actually do quite a bit of checking here. I misread the board texture. It's a paired board, queen 5-5. We actually do a lot of checking on this board. This hand probably might also be checking back. I thought it was like queen 5-2s, but on a paired board we actually do quite a bit of checking, and squeezing is fine. Yeah, that's the kind of problem with, like, folding here is just icky. But if this guy doesn't call edgy card, then I would not squeeze ace queen, so we would just call. You might even be okay if you called here. Like, I don't think it'd be a big mistake. But I think ace queen suited is somewhat too strong to be calling. Yeah, seems fine. So we kind of just continue checking the turn. We don't really bet here. and I won't get into this. It's not going to be a big mistake if you bet the turn, but like theoretically, it's actually 100% check on ace high. You don't bet this. Like ace high is one. When you see these sort of board textures, 4-5-6, 4-6-7 and stuff, and the turn's an ace, after the flop has gone check check, you don't really bet ace highs. And if you think about it, if you think about his range, your range, right? So you're pretty much checking your entire range here. So whatever you opened pre, you still have the same range on the turn. But he, on the other hand, is going to bet all his pocket fives, 7-6 suited, 5-6 suited, nines, eights, 7-6s, fours, a lot of flush draws he's going to bet, because he's not going to be check raised that often on this board texture. So he's going to, like, even a hand like Jack 10 of clubs, he's probably going to bet. What is he not going to bet? His ace highs, which also have some showdown. Right. So those hands are basically not going to bet. So if you check here and the turn is a five, you actually should go ahead and bet everything. Because since he checked the flop, now this becomes your turn, the five. But since you checked the flop, the ace is not your turn, because you still have kings, queens, jacks, tens. You checked, you're checking your entire range. You still have 8-7 suited, because you're checking your entire range on the flop. So you have all those hands, but he's now more weighted towards ace size.
Got it. Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, calling's fine. I would not fold the flop. We should not be folding ace jack here. I think it is way too strong, even on this board texture. What did we do? We checked. No, why? This is too fancy play. It's just jam.
Yeah, I and again, most of the things which I see now, I do realize that this shouldn't have been done. So
this is specifically called FPS, fancy play syndrome. It's a disease. Okay. Yeah, just jam. Seems fine. So why not just call here? Why would you jam?
True.
Well, look, kings jam karo. Is this jam karo? And this is SP versus PP. Just heads up. In position. You just don't want him to fold. Like, you're going to be flatting here so often. Right? BB versus SP. You're going to be flatting so often here that you want to have some strong hands. And this is like by far the best hand you can have.
Right. And most of the time, what happens, you know, when I get into this mode, often time I think I need a double up. I had to do something for double up. You know?
Yeah, exactly, so why you call, right?
Yeah.
You want a double
understand.
Up. But I think your problem is mainly not related to poker. It's, you probably are not playing professionally. In that case, you're playing less number of tables. So every tournament becomes too important. Like, the importance of every tournament is too much for you. And that's the reason. Like, you need to think about every hand as a different hand. So it's like, let's say you go to a job and your boss gives you some work to do. You do it. Next day, he gives you another task. You do it. Poker is the same. Basically, the table's your boss. It gives you hands. You play that. Every new hand is a new task. What happened in the previous hand is irrelevant. You have 10 BBs now. Your job is to deal with 10 big blinds. You double up, triple up, and you end up having 60 big blinds. Your new job is to deal with 60 big blinds. You get a massive suck out, and you're now left with 6 big blinds. Sure, it's a new job. Yeah. You now have 6 big blinds. Your job is to play with those 6 big blinds. Don't think about, oh my God, I have to recover, I have to do this. No, that's gambler's fallacy. It's not a good mentality to have in poker. Yeah, check call is fine. And river, I would lead. Probably, like, river is one spot you can block bet. And the reason we can block bet here is once he checks the turn, it's kind of hard for him to have any hands that are going to raise the river. But he still has so many 10Xs. He still has some 8Xs. People are still going to have 6s and 7s here. So you can actually get value from a lot of first hands. If you bet big here, he probably just folds 8x and 6s and 5, 4-5 suited or ace-5 suited, which people would have bet on the flop. They would just fold that. Right? He can still have some worse queen x's. That's also possible. Queen 9 suited is also possible. So I would just bet small,
But
something
value
like
bet, okay.
55, 60k, and we make sure that every 8x, 10x always calls. And if he's sticky, he might even call off with hands like 6s and 7s. But it is going to be very hard for you to get raised if you in this on this river. Yeah, so we missed so much value versus a 10.
Right. If I did a value bet there, if I would have, yeah,
And
got
that's why
called.
we bet a size like 60k or something on the river, because we kind of make him cry and call his 8x and 10x, because that's a good price we're giving him. And at the same time, we kind of we kind of get to bet a wider range over here. And it's impossible for us to get, not impossible, but it's going to happen maybe 5 out of 100 times that you get raised on the river. And Usme say, let's say even if he's bluffing, then probably 2 out of 100 times you get bluffed. So you don't need to worry about that ever happening. Yeah, seems fine. Could size down a little bit because of stack sizes. No, tens is too strong. This is way too passive. Either limp or raise. Do not ever jam tens for so many big blinds. This is just too strong. You want him to call, you want him to 3-bet, you want him to jam. What you don't want him to do is fold. And the maximum fold equity you can have is by going all in. So that's the thing you just never want to do. Everything else you do is fine. You limp, it's fine. You raise, it's fine. Anything you do is fine. Just jamming is just extremely bad. You just don't want him to fold.
Right. Luckily, I got caught there, but yeah,
I mean, he
it
had a
would have been
standard
better
hand to
if,
call off, but
yeah.
that situation is irrelevant, because whether you raise or jam, it's going to happen. But his other part that he folds.
Yeah.
Yeah, look at your sizing here. So this is quite good. You could even size down a little bit more, but I mean, this is also just okay. And definitely, definitely, definitely bet the turn. The reason
Okay.
is, when you size down, he floats a lot of hands. He still has gut shots and stuff. He still has 3x's. Oh wait, he called from the big blind or small blind? He called from the small blind. I don't think you should bet the flop at all versus the small blind.
Okay.
Versus big blind, we bet this. I didn't see you were from the small blind, but I'm not going to spend time into small blind today. So we'll just assume you're not aware of it, and I'm not aware of anything related to small blind. But small blind play is very, very different. Like versus small blind, you play very different than what you play versus big blind, because the ranges, the tightest range on the table is going to be probably the calling range is probably going to be somewhere in the small blind. Not the tightest, but like pretty tight. And quite unbalanced in that sense. Yeah, seems fine. Oh, I don't think we can fold now. Pretty easy call off. What? No. This is not a fold. Very, very easy call off. You need to. So one thing is, what the least important thing in a tournament is your tournament life.
Right, and I
It's
think
the
that's the
least
point
important
I
thing.
was thinking while folding that
Yeah, that's why I said, right?
yeah, I didn't
Everyone
want it
just
to
gives
knock
so
a bet
much
knocked out,
weightage, so much weightage to. I would rather get knocked out here. Trust me. I want to get knocked out here. The reason is, I don't want to spend another 1-2 hours and then win 5% more chips and then get knocked out. I mean, knock me out now. I can go sleep. I can rest. Why waste? Like, that's why, like, if it's the first hand of the tournament and I have a hand, I can basically go hyper aggro and I have to a close decision. I'd rather call it off. Even if it's close or just slightly minus, I'm screw it. I'll call it off. Because if I get busted, then it's better than grinding for another 3 hours, 4 hours, and then going near in the money and getting busted. Or if you're already in the money, then going deeper and deeper for not really any significant pay jump. But if you get knocked out here, you save time and you double up, you increase your chances to win. The other thing which most people don't understand is that at 2 million, you can still do a lot more damage than you should be allowed to do. Because what you're thinking, my tournament life, other guys are more worried when they have 600k, 500k. And you can actually, like ICM or maths doesn't take into calculation all these factors. And regardless, ace queen off here for 40 big blinds is just not a fold. It's one of the, it's probably one of the easier calls in this sport. He should jam hands like ace 10 suited. He should jam ace check off. He should probably even jam if he's good. Maybe he finds ace 5 suited as a bluff jam. He has 9s, 8s, 7s. And even if he doesn't have ace 5 suited, right? Let's say he just has 6s plus and ace king and ace queen. You still have the equity once you made it 200k. It's just plain maths. You have to call 200k and add 9-1. So you have to call, what's his size? It's overlapping, I think. Yeah, okay. So you have to call somewhere around 800k to win 2.2-ish. 1.3 plus 2.15.
2.1, yeah.
Yeah. So I don't think we can get to fold here. So, I mean, let's do it this way. Let's just make it simple here. The pot is 1.4 and you have to call 800. So... How do you calculate this? If you want to solve this part here.
So what I was basically thinking, and since I'm thinking of what if he has a, you know, any pockets, and I don't hit.
Forget that. It doesn't matter whether you hit or not. That's not what our concern is. My question is, how do you mathematically decide whether this is a call or not? Because every time you mathematically make a wrong decision, which is extremely bad, as in higher minus EV decision, you're actually making the field softer by doing that. Because you're not exploiting anyone. You're actually exploiting yourself. So do this as a homework, this pot, where assume the pot is 1.4. You already invested 200 and you basically have to call 800 to win a 2.2 million pot. So what's the kind of equity you need? Once you figure that out, that this is the equity I need to call off, ignore ICM and stuff for now, but this is the equity I need to call off. Then take that and put it in a software like Equilab and check his range and enter ace queen off and then see whether you have that equity or not. And then you realize you made such a huge mistake by folding here, and by huge I mean it's actually a huge mistake. But do that as homework, and it's actually quite easy to do it. This is a fold. We do not call this here, and you'd be surprised that you'll also be folding ace x's here. I think ace 8, ace 7, ace 6 are just plain folds. You don't even defend that. And I don't think people ever fold ace-x here, but they're not going to be defense. Their defense, if like king 7 off is already pretty marginal versus UTG open as a defend. As soon as you get one more caller, and as the caller's position goes further and further away from button, your range starts getting tighter and tighter from BB. Yeah, please don't do this. And why don't do this, what I mean is that don't change your three bet size based on your hand, because every time you do that, your aces will start going smaller in three bet size and your ace king and pocket queen sizes will start going bigger, because mentally you don't want to see a flop and you like pre-flop you all in ho jaye to achha hai, but aisa nahi hai. We want to give him room to go ahead and jam wide, because the moment you do this, someone sitting with nines is already crying and clicking on that fold, any fold button. You don't want to do that. So here, like I said, like he's already fairly short. So your sizing can be somewhere around 140 or so, simply because he's so short. Yeah, I mean, he's already crying when he sees this.
Right, got it.
Too big, way too big. And look at his size, look at his stack size. If you bet one big blind here, that's it. One big blind. Why do you even want to bet anything more? The smaller effective stack there is, the smaller and smaller in sizing you want to go. And I'll tell you what, like, forget in any sport that you confused, right? MTTs are very simple in that sense. In any sport you get confused, you bet one third. There is rarely, like, you can actually ignore all the huge 50%, 70% sizes. And you just say, I'll bet one third of my entire range every single time. You'll still be playing better than choosing all this mix, big sizings and small sizings and various sizing, because the mistakes you make doing those big sizings are very costly.
Got it.
Yeah, I would just bet the flop. I don't think we need to check flop at all. Like, sure, we want to have some flush draws in our check pack range, but I don't think it's relevant in this spot. I think if you want the button or something, maybe you could think about checking, but yeah, it's a straight up bet. Oops, don't suck diamond. Do you have roughly any idea as to how long the tournament goes from here, or when the final table is? Oh, we're quite close. Yeah, I think we can finish. I was like, if you just middle stage, then it might take too long.
Yeah, we are almost, it won't take much time. But I would say we'll cover everything rather than skipping to final table, because I'm
making few notes. We're not skipping anything. I was trying to skip something in the middle if we had less time, but I think we have more than enough time. Here, I would bet the flop.
Because now I'm realizing how badly I'm playing, you know.
No, I think you're somewhat. I think what has happened in your case is that you are aware of certain fundamentals, but that has come more from maybe just reading or doing some, like, just watching someone play.
Yeah.
But what has it's basically like this, right? You tried to make a building, a 10-story building, but you forgot to build the ground floor and first floor and second floor. Straight away, you trying to jump on the third floor. Aisa kaise hawa mein thodi building khadi rahegi. You need some base, right? So what you should be doing, the first thing you should be doing is sticking to pre-flop ranges. And it's going to be hard to adjust, because MTTs, it gets very tricky, because you have 15 big blinds, 20 big blinds, 30 big blinds, 40 big blinds, 60 big blinds. And sometimes you have 60 big blinds, but your opponents don't have. Then also your range changes. So it's a little difficult, but the time you spend there, so 80% of your game, whether you're good or bad, is already decided pre-flop. At 20, 30 big blinds, there's very little room there to be creative in post-flop situations. Majority of your win rate is going to come from push flow. That's why, like, when to the students that I coach, I always tell them you should be running at least 20, 30 hands in ICMizer or HRC daily, which is basically to check your push flow ranges, because that is basically your bread and butter. It's okay if you're not good post flop. It's fine. You'd rather spend more time getting your pre-flop push flow game correct, or your pre-flop opening and calling ranges correct.
Okay.
Would size down a little bit, because we have a relatively wide-ish three betting range. I think this is a little too big. Like, maybe 225K. Yeah, a little bigger than three. So, like, 220K or 225K is fine. Yeah, seems fine. Good size down again. A little bit, like 330 or so. It's 340, 330 or something, but it's fine. Like, we're not going to get too much into size. I think once you work on your pre-flop game, this will just naturally follow. What did he jam? Seems okay. Oh, is this already the final table?
Yeah. This is the final
table. We should have looked into all those spots. So, on a final table, we are never checking this. There's some things that are just going to happen that we're never going to do that. And I think if it's a final table from this spot, I think we'll try to look at all hands. Like, so koi to rok lo. So here, like, first of all, you should make a note. Koi to rok lo is a reg. Flopzilla is reg, I think is a little bit tight. Varun seems extremely passive, but that could also be just a hand sample issue. GSK seems like a reg. So this is overall reg. And Koito Roklo is going to be opening way too many hands. So you should be attacking him. Like you should be finding spots to attack him. But I don't think we'll get any spots though. So yeah, this is a good fold. Even a hand like King Jack off here is very, very marginal. Like even Ace 10 off, you should probably just fold. Queen Jack off, just fold. King Jack off is also just kind of fold. So these are aces. We fold this. Yep. Yeah, now there's very little ice. This is one. No, there is still like. What I want to explain is like you should, that I'm not, like, it's not related to this play, but you should understand that on this table, the maximum ICM pressure is going to be on you. So your range is something that is going to be fairly tight. The least ICM pressure is on No Chance because he's the shortest. It doesn't really matter. And same with like Koito Roklo would be like the second least ICM pressure on him. The thing you need to understand is like you need to adjust your final table gameplay with this information. In general, though, I would not give too much importance to ICM, but you should be aware that this is like this is adjustment you should be making. And I would still go ahead and make some minus EV ICM plays for various reasons. But if we get into such a spot, we will cover that topic. But I think for now, we'll just see how what you do. Like this open is absolutely fine. And we fold. This is good. Like even hands like 8-9 off and even hand like 9-10 off, king 8 off. King 8 off probably not, but like king 7 off, king 6 off. No, maybe not even this. But I think all these 9-8 off, 6-7 off and all those hands I would just fold. Probably not fold the high card hands. Because in these spots, it is there's no playability required. Like a 6-7 suited is just a trash hand because you're sitting with 10 big blinds. There's no check raise bluffs and check raise then barrel turns and bluff.
Right.
You know, whatever you're gonna what is gonna happen is gonna be over on the flop because you're not really gonna do any calling. You pretty much are gonna play if he bets, you kind of just get it in. And for that, you need cards that block his value range. And you need cards that flop could top pairs. Because if you have, say, 7-8 off and the board is king 7 deuce and he bets, you kind of have to jam. It's already quite bad to jam. If he calls, it's yuck. But on a board like king 7 deuce, if you have king 5, king 6 off or king 8 off, he can have queen x, he can have 7x. So in the shorter your stack is, give less and less importance to all these suited connectors and stuff and give more importance to hands that actually block his value range and you're comfortable stacking off. So hands that can basically good one pair hands. So like king six off on king high board is really good, but 7-8 suited on king 7-3 isn't really that great.
Got it.
I mean, I don't know what he's doing, but if he's not exploiting you or is allowing you, like if it's the first hand, I would just go ahead and limp. And then if he raises and we get some information that he's exploiting us or he's aggressive, then I would stop doing it. Yeah, seems fine. He's short, opening into a short stack. Yeah, this is just bad, but it doesn't matter. Yep, we're not opening much to him. Easy call off. Yeah, we're not going to go out of line versus his stack. And this is also like, I'm really surprised why he's even limping here. No. Oh, we just fold this. Like, I don't understand why you would fold king nine here.
Right. And flash.
Yeah. And another thing is you are short here. So your risk is 1.5 million. Translated to whatever dollars it ICM tells you to, that's your risk. Right? And there's five people left. So there's less risk in terms of dollars. But now there's
And
more.
that happens most of the time, because I do think, like, you know, if I you know, flat, maybe he checks back, and then if I
Yeah,
get
so
lucky,
king
something
nine
like
off is better, right? High card.
that.
We just discussed that, like king, like even a 9x is still a decent 9x with a good kicker. King high is already usually going to be top pair. And 10-4 off, everything is bad. Even if you hit a 10, you probably have the worst kicker. If you hit a 4, what are you going to stack off? Plus, you are deep now. And on top of it, no chance is sitting there with like 5 big blinds, less than 5 big blinds. GSK, if he's really, really good, he should just be raising every single hand here. Even like some hands that he thinks might be good as checks, no, you just win the pot uncontested. This is going to happen. Every single hand he should just raise. Yeah, I'd be careful because GSK still should just be three betting or how deep are we? Yeah, I think he could still three bet very, very wide. Yeah, this is good fold. So I don't want to get into this part, but you need to work on a properly defined small blind strategy. Don't look at your hand and then just do anything you want to do. Right? Currently, that's what's happening. But the first step, like I said, go to your ranges and stick to that. Because if you're raising all these strongish hands here, what are you limping? Your limping range is so weak. So I'm not saying that raising this is wrong. But what I'm saying is like your strategy is just changing so much from based on what your exact hand is. Like sometimes you go small because you want him to call, sometimes you go big because you want him to fold or just randomly keep changing sizings. Even pre-flop, we've seen 2.5x, 2x, then 3-bet to 4x in position, and then 3x, 2.5x versus under the gun with nines and queens that we saw. So make a proper plan that if say between 20 to 40 big blinds, I'll always raise 3.2x. Then it doesn't matter what hand you have, what you want him to do. It's not important. You will always do 3.2x no matter what happens. When you're out of position and let's say you decide that at 50 big blinds plus, I'll make it 4.5x. Sub 50 BB up to 25, 30 big blinds, I'll make it 4x. If it's below 25 big blinds, then I'll make it 3.25x. Then stick to that, but make a note of it. So that is something you should do a bit of research. Maybe ask players what sort of sizings you should choose at different stack sizes. Make a note of that. Then open any app that can help you with ranges or any coaching material or find someone to help you make ranges yourself. But follow that, like that, just keep it open and follow that in game 100%. And since you're not playing too many tables, like do you play less than four tables, I assume?
Yeah,
Yeah, so
three,
when
three.
you Yeah, so you have enough time to look at ranges and then take your decisions pre-flop in every single hand. Of course, by every single hand, I mean it's like hands that you need to think about. If you have aces, you don't need to think about anything. If you're deuce 10 off, you don't need to think about anything. But when someone has opened and now you need to decide between calling and three betting, let's say you have ace queen suited. Do you want to three bet or do you want to call? Go to ranges. Look at, say, your 30 big blinds. What do I do? So go to 30 big blinds, check UTG versus button what you should do and stuff like that. But make sure you do that and make a standard plan and stick to it. Because what happens is when your pre-flop game is all over the place. So with nine, sometimes you do 50k, sometimes you do 30k, sometimes you do 100k. Like hypothetically, when you get to post-flop, you now have to play three different situations. One when you made it to three big blinds, one when you made it to 3.5, and one when you made it to 4.5. Whatever it is, like pre-flop size, what you choose. You don't want to do that. You want to simplify your pre-flop game, simplify these decisions, and stick to one standard sizings. And the more you think about all these things that I'm trying to exploit, understand one thing, you're not exploiting anyone. You are simply exploiting yourself.
Got it.
I don't mind just calling this. And if we do three bet, so like here. I don't really understand this size either. Like you're out of position. You are going to have a very strong range. You're never ever going to be kind of having like Shark Tank, like, you know, not merge it in. You're probably gonna have a very polarized and very, in general, I don't think even you have 3-bet bluffs, because your 3-bet bluffs are also coming from your linear range. So in that case, you should probably end up going a lot bigger, somewhere around, like, this is very, very small. Probably something in the range of 500K is what you should be going. This is just way too small.
Okay. Yeah, and my idea was also like that I don't want to see the flop.
No, you always want. Why does Ace Track of not want to see this flop? So I'll tell you what. If after four betting you don't see the flop, and you're supposed to fold for whatever reason, you shouldn't really be looking at folding. But if you're supposed to fold, it's already quite bad. If you get called, it's good, because his calling range is probably is something that you're going to dominate. So he's going to have Jack 10 suited. He's going to have worse ace X. He's going to have Queen Jack. He's going to have King Jack. And you dominate all of those hands. So you don't really want him to fold when you have these hands. You want him to call. Sure. When do you want him to fold? When you have 3-bet plus. And what did I just say? You probably don't have 3-bet plus at all. If that's the case, you always want him to call. At the very, like, basically, yeah, I mean, like, it's when your range is so linear, when your range is so value heavy, just go on a larger sizing. Plus, you're out of position, right? So 350K here is way, way, way too big, way too small. Yeah, I don't think we do anything. Just go check it down. And I don't think this will work very often. Just give me 1 second.
Okay. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. I don't think that 8-10 of fluff is going to work very often. I think that the simple reason is because I think if he had fluffs, I think there's way high chance of him continuing on the turn.
So he checks turn as well.
Yeah, because you still have some ace X's that are going to call the flop. You still have some weaker jack X's that he can triple battle and fold you out. I think you're often going to see hands like, I think like queen five, queen six kind of hands that are just going to end up calling the river. And especially with the flush draw missed, I think people end up heroing more than they should. Close. Like, you're probably just going to get called by these sort of hands. It won't be king five, king six. It will always be hands like queen three, queen five also. It will also not be hands like, say, ace queen, because ace queen will still keep battling. Strong queen x will still keep battling. So I don't think this bluff really works. Yeah, I think you're going to have a little bit of trouble here. And the simple reason is because when you're playing 300, you need to play a lot of hands. And at the same time, you're also not really comfortable stacking off when you have like a lot of chips. So like 40, 50 big blinds. So what I would do as an exploit, and I would suggest, like, when you come across such a final table where you're very deep and your opponents have an extremely big skill edge versus you, you need to reduce that skill edge. So basically, you don't want to see a lot of flops. So let's say your threshold for jamming was...
The same thing happens over here.
Yeah. So like when you have like 30, 35, 40, even 40 big blinds, right? And you have some spots that you... So for example, let's go here. Let's say he does this and you have exactly like 2 million or something. That's 40 big blinds. You should just jam it free.
Right. Okay.
Because when you jam it, it's called an unexploitable shove. So he can't really exploit you. Post flop, this deep, you are going to get exploited very, very hard. So in general, you should tighten up here, which you're already doing. But I'm just giving like a general guide. You should tighten up here and look at even jamming at say 40 big blinds or so, you can easily play push fold. When you're out of position, then even like 40, 45 big blinds, you can just open shove. Not open shove, three bet shove.
Okay.
So this is, obviously we're not jamming this in position, but like I was just a basic understanding. And flop goes check, check. Seems okay. Yeah, this is a good bluff and probably size up a little bit because Koito Rokuro is not going to fold. Like you should look at his fold to three bet stuff and stats here. But if you're not looking at a HUD, even then it's kind of okay.
Yeah, and I think that happens because he jams over here and then I cannot call.
But... yeah, that's okay. That's fine. It doesn't matter if he jams. But like you should be looking at that. Like don't look at these because I think he's one of our stable guys. That's why there's like 16,000 hands on him because I've done his hand histories and stuff. But what I'm trying to tell you is that your three bet is not fine, not wrong. But at this stack depth, like I would still much prefer to have these suited ace x's and stuff, SP versus PB into a calling range. And you're choosing a bluff, then you probably don't want to choose this hand. Like it's a kind of misconception that you should choose you'd rather choose a hand like ace three off him as your three bet bluff in this spot. You don't want to fold ace three suited. And then there are some other bluffs, which I don't want to tell you right now. First, you look at your preflop ranges and do that, but they're nowhere close to the kind of thing, kind of hands that you think they are.
Okay.
Because those are bluffs that have really, they basically block your opponent's high card heavy range and you have no problem folding them. Ace three suited is a disaster to fold, right? Yeah, see again, you go from making it to 135 at 2040 to making it not even 2.2 at this. Basically, you're literally just playing your hand strength. So every time this is going to happen, you are going to get punished for this. So consistent preflop strategy is the most important
which I
thing
need to work on.
Yeah. So if you're going to make a raise here to 3.25x or whatever size you choose, you're going to do that every single time. If it aces, oh yeah, do seven and offer, it doesn't matter.
Samja. Got it.
You should be aware of one thing. So let's say you are the small blind, right? And you limped. And this is the board texture. What do you do with your sort of your range? So you also have some weak ace-x, you have some jack-10, you have some king-3 off kind of hands that you limp. So what is your general strategy as SP? Forget 6-7 off.
I'm
forget
it.
Yeah. So now think about it. Let's take a rather different flop. Let's take an ace-6 juice. What do you, a rainbow, what do you do now?
I think I'll pretty much min bet any
board. So now think about it. When you raise pre, you have all the strong ace x's. When you limp pre, he still has those weak ace x's, which he had because all the strong ace x's like ace queen, ace jack are still gonna three bet stack off, whether you raise or limp. Right. So he still has those, but you now don't have those hands. You don't have sixes. You don't have a6s, the stronger ones. So now your range, when you limp, your range has actually gotten weaker. Your range actually doesn't want, like you have weak 6xs. You have like some middling stuff. Like let's say even if you slow played, you still have kings that slow played. That don't really benefit from betting. That's like your top of your value range that I'm talking about. And then some weak a6s that also don't mind giving a free check. So things complete, like don't get that's why, like don't look at SP versus BB and ace high board is my board. It's not, you limped. It's no longer your board. If you raise, it is always your board. If you limped, things change. So that's why I said, like, don't look at position as in look at range versus range. Your range now does not have these a strong ace sixes. So you don't have that big of an equity advantage or nut advantage that you thought you had. If you had raised, this is then that A6 juice rainbow would definitely be your board. So the reason why I'm saying this is when you do this, of course, we're going to bet here, but you should understand that he is still going to end up showing with stronger hands than you expect, because he knows that you should be checking ace high boards, SP versus PB when you're the limper. So he'll be checking a lot. Yeah, I mean, this hand is doesn't matter in terms of the result. Like, I would still fold the river, but so if you think about his entire hand strength, if he was going to bluff, he would have bet the flop. So on the flop itself, he says his story is I have showdown, or I have some equity, or I have some sort of hands that don't really want to check raise. So what are those hands going to be? The weakish part of his range. Like if he has a 6x or a 5x or something, he still doesn't want to bet the river because he doesn't want to be blown. Like he's just going to check. So all that weakish hands are still checking. Now, if you even look at his bluffs will have to be hands like some sort of missed straight draws because flush draw already got there. So only missed straight draws are now really possible. That's the only thing you beat. You don't beat anything else. King high, if he had, like if he check calls a king high, he has showdown, he's not going to bet that. And we don't beat that either.
Correct.
But
yeah.
For
so
that,
the river was a fold there.
You have a seven in your hand, which basically blocks majority of his missed straight draws. 7, 8, 7, 9.
Right.
And people don't turn a hand like five into a bluff here. No, they don't do that. They just take it as showdown. So if you actually try to think about his value range, he has all flushes possible. He has ace-x's possible. He even has some slow-played hands possible. He has two pairs possible. But bluffs may, he has only very few combos of 7x's because he's probably even going to check-raise some straight draws. And usme bhi agar, let's say he doesn't check-raise any straight draw, hypothetically. Even then you have a 7, you block a large part of his bluffs.
True, yeah.
Yeah, even multiple like king 3-3. So I don't want to get into it because small blind changes a lot and the game's very different. Hanji sir, why are we calling here?
True, and I don't know why I did that. Because if Koito Roklo doesn't call, then I'm definitely calling. But,
of course you're not calling. And that's why I said before the start of this hand, SP play is very different. Because, let's think about it. For you to call, let's assume Koito Roklo folds. For you to call here and be profitable, you need to, basically needs to have a hand which is worse than a five or a bluff. So please tell me what are his bluffs. And for this, start pre-flop. What do you think is preflop ranges? Narrow it down on the flop. Flop, there's no narrowing down because everyone checked back. On the turn, he doesn't bet. So narrow down further. On the river, now he bets into three people, into two people. Mm-hmm. And a very small sizing. A sizing that literally never represents a bluff.
True. And I agree with you. But, you know, paying 95K to get a pot of like 400K plus, like...
Of course. That's, so do that. That's your second homework. Mm-hmm. So you, let's say you're on the river, your opponent, it's $1 million pot. You have to call 100 rupees. That's what the all-in amount is on the river, right? Okay. And you have some hand, but your opponent accidentally exposes you the nuts. Would you call? You only have to call 100 to win a million. But your opponent is accidentally exposed that he has the nuts.
No, of course, then I'm not calling.
So now translated to over here, I gave you a very extreme example. You have that number, sure. You have to call 95K to win almost 500K, correct?
Right.
So take that, what you have, translate it to how much percentage of the time you need to be correct to call here. That's your first homework. Second homework is, after knowing that you should be, say you get a hypothetical percentage that this is the percentage of time you should be, like this is the equity you need to call. In that case, now take his range. Because in all this, you simply did not consider anyone's range. For him to do that, he still needs to have bluffs 1 and 5 times. Sorry, as in, so it's going to be impossible for you to get to that number, 1 in 4 times. It's going to be impossible for you to get there because I just want you to look at, just find out two bluffs that you think he has here, assuming Koi to Roklo folds. Just two combos of bluffs.
No, yeah, I'm not thinking he has bluff. I'm just thinking about the, you know, the amount which I have to pay. So
Yes, I
I
agree, but
never
उसको उसकी
thought,
रेंज
but
से कनेक्ट करना है ना. When you
okay.
get that amount, वो तो फिर तो ऐसा हुआ ना, मैं ज्यादा रिस्क ले सकता हूँ तो मैं तो 99% बिहाइंड हूँ तो भी कॉल कर सकता हूँ. एंड तुम कम रिस्क ले सकते हो तो यू शुड ओनली कॉल 1%. दैट्स नॉट हाउ पोकर इज प्लेड, राइट? यू व्हेन यू गेट दैट नंबर, नाउ यू टेक हिज रेंज, पुट दिस बोर्ड टेक्सचर एंड सी इफ यू हैव द ऑड्स और नॉट. वेरी सिंपल, आई ओनली हैव टू कॉल 99 टू विन 500K. अरे बट उसका क्या करोगे? मैं भी बोलता हूँ आई ओनली हैव टू कॉल 500K टू विन 500K. सो वॉट आर वी डिबेटिंग? हुज राइट, हुज रॉन्ग?
True. I don't think there are many bluffs over here. Kuch
They literally know his
mis
hands are,
right.
is also very face up, going to be something like eights and nines here, or maybe king
King X or
king. No, it's king X is also almost impossible. He probably lead the turn, but if he does show, probably show something like king nine suited or so, king nine suited, king 10 off, maybe. But I think he 3-bet bluffs those. I think we just often see hands like eights and nines here, to be honest. This is, if he shows this, then actually well played, because I don't think people do a lot of flatting with hands like these, which are actually good flats, king six suited. But yeah, that's what, Rick, this table isn't really that soft, so you need to reduce the edge they have on you, and that's by playing less and less post up and pushing them to a high variance spot of, let's say, it's you even enter in a flip situation with fours versus ace king. That's good for you and bad for them. So, and like I said, once he calls Koi to Roklo, so we are 100% folding.
100% folding. Yeah.
So this is not a fold by any means. The worst thing you do is fold. But this is going to be one of your best check raise bluffs. And this is literally 100, almost you can check raise bluff this 100% frequency. And the reason for that is, so why this is so good is because of the king. The king has two benefits. It blocks a few of his value range. Secondly, if you check raise bluff and he already has a made hand, you still have some outs to hit your king and outdraw him. Correct? Plus you have backdoor flush draw. And the most important factor is that you have a your third card seven is between the top two cards, and where you even hit backdoor straight draws and stuff. So in general, when you have a card which is going to be in between the top two cards, and a backdoor straight draw is possible, that's really good bluff three betting hands. Add it with backdoor flush draw, add it with the King X blocker and the King X, the fact that we can still outdraw him. And you'd be surprised that you will also get folds, and he'll also have worse hands that will fold. So remember in the start, I told you we always get want worse hands to fold and call and better hands to fold. This is one spot where if a worse hand folds, we don't mind. The reason for that is even a worse hand has a lot of equity versus us. Let's see, as Jack 10 suited and he folds, it's not bad for us because Jack 10 suited battles the turn, we can't do anything. So we have very poor equity realization. So this hand, the worst thing you can do is fold. Fold is just literally never happening here. Three-handed, if you start folding this, you'll basically just start blinding down without even knowing how I went from 3 million to like 1.5 million. So work on, I think the second step you should work on is BP defend and widening your flop raising range and your flop calling range.
Okay, and the consistency with the
Yeah, that's the first step. Like, this is the second step, which I said. So if you look at here, you look at the sizing. He makes it 100K, he makes it 500K. You made it 348K. And that time it was like, you should be making it at least 500K.
Right.
Yeah, I think we just. Oh, this is not a jam. this is definitely not going to be a jam.
Yeah, and this is the last hand as well.
So we'll just put this
in. I was literally going down blinds, and I was like,
"You think you're getting too impatient? You need to differentiate between casino and poker, because you're playing. Your mentality is still stuck at the blackjack table. You need to forget that."
Okay.
So I think he raises a lot wider than this. So we won't go much in detail in this. But basically, this is your jamming range. It's bad, but it's not like crazy bad. So in your case, like looking at it, like probably this is too weak, but let's say hands like ace 4, ace 6, it's slightly minus EV, but you should take that. You should still jam ace 4, ace 6. So versus these guys, a lot of your, so what we can do is, something like this. So few more hands, but this is basically what you should be doing day in and day out.
Okay.
And this is going to be your bread and butter. What is going to happen is like when you play poker, you are not going to be able to calculate this in game. It's impossible. Even if you have this software open for every single hand, then you probably end up playing one tournament a day. So you can't even do that. So the next best option is when you do this hand history, right? The entire hand history you should load here, or at least every single day mark hands and have at least 25, 30 spots. Now, let's say we're just looking at simple push fold spots. Even one hand itself will end up into like multiple spots. So for example, here, first of all, BB jams, SP jams, what should you do? So then you have your BB call range. This is SP's jamming range. But at the same time, like now, how do you work on this is basically, let's say I know that SP is a very tight guy, right? So then I'll edit his range. And let's say I don't think SP jams this range. Maybe he's too tight. This is a hypothetical situation.
Okay.
And then you again calculate. And then this is your calling range. Let's say SP is so wide, so aggro, I think he will jam 100% of his range. Oof. Yeah. And this is your calling range. See how it changed. So one spot itself, you could do this 100 times, and then what you're going to do in game, it's not going to be your maths in game. It's going to come from memory. Because you run the spot, different spots, no spot is going to be the same. So whenever you run into such a situation, your spot is going to be something, okay, I think maybe ace-9 is a call. And then what is in reality is going to happen is maybe ace-7 was a call, maybe even ace-jack was a fold. So the more you practice, the closer you're going to be to that, what is the correct push call range and fold range. But in general, so I think...
I'm on a small blind.
No, this was just a hypothetical example. We don't need to look at it. Like the hand's already over. But like I said, I haven't used ICMIs in the past one and a half years, but I can still see that and like see the hand and I can tell you that, okay, this is not going to be a jam.
Okay.
But if you are playing tournaments, because I don't play tournaments much now, but if you're playing tournaments, you should be running these like at least 30, 40 hands a day. There should be no such situation where you confused like what I should do. Like we ran into the ace queen where I also got confused like what we should do in the initially when we got three bet. So for an MTT player, that should not happen because that's your bread and butter. That just cannot happen. So work on, when I used to play MTTs, I used to run at least 30, 40 hands every single day. ICMIs was something which should be in your memory by default. You should not be thinking about, you should not be making such huge mistakes. Small mistakes are okay, but this is like quite a big mistake. So work on that. So first thing is, I think you should work on your preflop ranges, which is most crucial. Second is work on your consistent pre-flop sizings, and then third on your push fold. Flop वगैरह पे भूल जाओ अभी कुछ नहीं होता तो, but in position for you it's simple. You only have the choice to bet 33%. उसके आगे बेट ही मत करो. You, if you let's say there's a spot where you should bet 66% or large size or and you instead you bet small size, और वो mistake हो गई. That is okay. It's a small mistake, but it's a spot where you should check or bet really really small when he has like 15 big blinds and you end up betting 75% of pot. That's a blunder. So for now, you can simplify and make a small mistake in order to make your game simple, or you can keep making more and more mistakes and costlier mistakes by having multiple sizings. So in position for now, 33% sizing, no matter what texture it is, you can check, of course, either check or bet 33%, but don't have a large size at all for now.
Got it, got it.
Yeah, I think then we're done.
This, yeah, I and this was the last time.
You have any questions or doubts, or maybe if anyone else has any questions, we can take that.
Yeah, I think I told
For
them to ask
me,
about the
I
question.
have taken many notes.
Okay.
And thank you so much, Abhishek, for doing this.
No
I
worries, no
mean,
worries.
learned a lot, man.
Just make sure you at least like notes and all are okay, but make sure you implement on it because otherwise everything
Sure.
that you learn today is just kind of waste.
Definitely.
There's a question from Himanshu, but I think everybody can see the chat.
Yeah, in general, I think even your top pairs are going to be a bit tricky to call in multi-way spots, but it's not going to be on a specific board. So, for example, the board texture that you said is 7-8. So nines and tens are still marginal, but like maybe if it's three-way, you can peel sometimes. But it's even if you end up folding, it's not a big mistake. But if the board was say something like Queen 6-3, and then you get c-bet, and you were holding a hand like Queen 8 suited, you probably should be thinking about folding it on the flop itself. So even a top pair on that sort of a board texture is fairly complicated, and especially like if there's a bet and a call, then your top pair is in that spot. Like weak top pairs is going to be a fold, going to be folded. But on ace high boards, it's a little different because in general people overbluff ace high board textures, and I think that's one of the reasons we can get to peel one street. But it's still not going to be the like it's still not going to be a great spot multi-way. So if you end up being a little bit more tighter, it's not it's it's it, it's okay.
I think Gaurav had the question, I guess.
Yeah. So the problem, so Gaurav mentions that you should register 60 to 80 big blinds. The thing is, of course you will lose out something, but the problem is, if you will lose even more if you play 100 PBs incorrectly, because like I said, right, cutoff versus button. It's one of the most simplest spots. If you're playing 100 BB deep, cutoff versus button, you don't see bet at all. It's 0% see betting range. So if you see bet there, you're already making a mistake. And the thing is that it doesn't like it's not even worth it to invest such a big amount of time studying 100 BB fancy pre-flop and post-flop strategies because they don't happen a lot. Like here also, majority of the tournaments we've not even seen him above say 40, 50 big blinds was max, and that's why you should put a lot of focus on studying between 20 to 30 big blinds and little bit less focus on studying 30 to 60 big blinds and just probably ignore about 60 big blinds. And plus you'd rather like it also takes a lot of mental energy when you're playing 100 BBs. Why do you want to do that when majority of your money making decisions are going to be made at shortest actives? Yeah, so Akshay, you asked about the ace queen of V3 bet and BB 4 bet. That's why I said, right, even if it's nutted, and I give a very tight range, let's say he's only ace king plus and then pairs and then ace queen suited. Like maybe ace queen, basically he's ace queen plus and pairs. The problem is there's already 200K of us plus 50K plus the antes in the pot. So that just, it's simple. No, if you have $1 million pot and he's all in on the turn and you have to call $100, you probably won't even look at your cards and just call off. So sometimes match just dictates you to be calling off. I think we need less than 35%. I think it should be somewhere around 28 or so. But oh wait, no, it was 800 for 2.2. So yeah, we need 35%. And I'm pretty sure Ace Queen would have somewhere around way more than that, even not way, but like somewhere, I'm guessing somewhere around 40, 42, even versus Ace Queen plus on the range. Okay, I think we'll end the session here.
I think we can
wrap it up. No more questions. But if there are, just post in the relevant channels. I think I'll reply there.
Yeah, on Discord channel, anybody can like post in the relevant channels and we'll see. We'll try to answer the questions. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the reviews and everything. And thank you, everybody, for joining. We'll be posting our giveaways in our Discord and our Instagram. So we have some ticket giveaways, like surprise giveaways. We'll be announcing on Discord and Instagram. Thank you, everybody, and happy grinding. See you next time.
See you guys.